Welcome to the Little Home Church by the Wayside. Today is the fourth Sunday after Epiphany. My one and only, so many songs have been utilized, have utilized this phrase to express devoted love. This week we see that this tradition goes all the way back to the poets of the Psalms. Psalm 62 verses 5 through 12 is a psalm of trust in the Holy One and the Only, who is the rock and refuge in the midst of life that sometimes feels as fleeting as breath. We put our trust in the one who indeed is holding our lives. We also take a look at the gospel lesson and see how this must have applied to the life of Jesus as he gets rejected from his hometown of Nazareth and the temple. Our services are going to remain online for the first 2 weeks of February. February 6th and 13th will be virtual services only. We will begin in-person worship on February 20th. I put out a note earlier this week to our younger families about starting a kids club, an after-school meeting once a month that kids can come to center around fun activities and a service project. Our first service project will be assembling disaster relief kits for fire, flood, hurricane, and tornado victims. February 6th is our annual meeting at 11 o'clock, and we will make that a virtual meeting as well. The meeting will focus on the approval of the 2022 budget, an update from our Joyful, Joyful, We Restore the committee, and vote on some amendments to our bylaws. We need a quorum for that. Watch this week in your emails and your mail for ballots. We need to be sure that we have all of that in preparation for February 6th. Our monthly church council meeting is the following night, February 7th at 7 o'clock. That will be on Zoom only as well. February 27th will be our annual Fat Sunday and Mardi Gras celebration. The service will be anchored and full of New Orleans-style music. Every year, we collect new and gently used bras for the Save the Girls projects, which rescues women out of sex trafficking and sets them up in boutique businesses, part of which is selling bras. Our monthly newsletter, by the way, will come out this week. Be sure to read it cover to cover and stay up on what's happening in our church. Speaking of, an all-church book read will be starting in February and finishing in May. It's in my column, and by the way, Unlearning God by Philip Gully is the book. We will read four chapters a month, and we'll have book discussions over brunch one Sunday a month after church. Townhouse Books is offering a 10% discount if you order from them and mention Little Home Church. All meetings this week for church will be virtual, and you can see those when you click on the bulletin connected to the email for this service. Thank you.
Good morning. I hope this finds you warm after a frigid week of winter here. Please join me in unison for the call to worship. Our souls wait in silence. Our hope rests in God, our rock, our salvation, our refuge. We will not be shaken in this time of worship. We pour out our hearts because we trust in God's steadfast love.
My tears forever flow. All for sin could not atone. You must save, and you
please join me in the prayer of invocation. God of our devotion, you are the one constant in our lives. Open us this day to see the things that hold us in their grip, so that we might shed unnecessary distractions that keep us from seeing your reign on earth as it is in heaven. We praise you for being our rock, holding our lives together in ways that matter most. Amen. Now, if you will join me in the prayer of confession. O God, we are sorry that we became so engrossed with ourselves and our worldly matters. We do not give time to consider why you made us, who we are, and placed us where we are. Sometimes we feel that our affairs are too trivial to bring before you. We believe we can manage life by ourselves. Yet, we realize that we are part of your kingdom, that you created us and have a purpose for us. Forgive our self-centeredness and give us a wider vision, so that in you we may find our true selves and the reason for our being. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Words of assurance this morning. Sisters and brothers, our God is a God of compassion and mercy, slow to get angry and filled with unfailing love and faithfulness. So be at peace. Make your life a prayer. Amen. Inside me there.
find another voice inside my mind. He comforts me and bids me live inside.
Boys and girls, I'd like to talk to you today about a word that happens in one of our Bible stories today that Louise is going to read for us in just a little bit. And the word is being rejected. So I don't know, maybe when you're watching this at home this week, you can talk with adults around and talk about what that means to be rejected or to feel rejected. And that might be something that's happened to you before. Maybe you've done it to somebody before. But some examples might be like when we're in school and you're playing with your friends that you always play with. And say that you want to invite somebody else in to play with your group, but your other friends say, no, we don't want that person. That's rejecting someone. Maybe you've been the person who wanted to be in the group of kids who were playing, and they rejected you. And it doesn't feel very good, does it? One of the things we can do to stop rejection is to just accept people. And maybe the right thing to do would be to walk away from the friends who didn't want to accept somebody into the group and start a new set of friends with the person who is being left out of something. So how does that fit into our Bible story today? Well, since we're at the beginning of the year, we've just come through the pageant, and Jesus was born, and we know that part of the Christmas story very well. And then the story moves really quickly ahead. We don't know much about Jesus when he was a little boy, or even a young man. It goes right into a time when he's an adult and he starts what we call his ministry, teaching his stories of love and kindness. So Jesus was out with his disciples and he came back to his hometown of Nazareth. Now, when you come home, say after a long vacation, maybe you have cousins or relatives, and they moved away, but they come back for a visit or something, isn't that a great feeling? You always welcome them. And you're happy to see them. Well, it kind of started that way for Jesus in the story, but it didn't end up that way. So they'd heard all these wonderful things that Jesus was doing for so many people in other parts of the country and in other cities and towns. But when Jesus came back to the synagogue, to what was their place to worship, like our church, he made some examples in some stories that we were to be kind to everyone, not just people like us, not just our own family and our own friends, but that God wanted us to love everybody. And to be honest, some people didn't like hearing that. They wanted to just be the special ones, and it made them very mad, and they said really bad things about Jesus then, and they rejected him. So what I want you to remember this week for yourselves, as you watch in school and things, that sort of thing happens all the time in life around us. But see if you see somebody being rejected, if you can't just accept them and bring them into your group of friends or something and make them feel loved and special. Let's put our hands together and say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We'll continue in that spirit of prayer with our pastoral prayer. Some joys and concerns that have come in this week. Joyful that Doug Hancock and Mona Rose have both returned home from Mary and Joy. I talked with Ruth this week, and Ruth has some health issues that have surfaced, and we want to keep Ruth in our prayers. We still continue to pray for Carol Berger, who's in California, mourning the loss of her sister Linda. We want to continue to hold Carly Zelotis, our 18-year-old neighbor who's suffering from a rare form of leukemia, in our prayers. And once again, a good friend, a piano friend of both Nancy Sen and myself, Constance Hughes and her family. Constance's burial mass was held today after she was killed in a tragic car accident. Also, from a world standpoint, we would want to also remember those in Tonga who suffered the terrible devastation this week as well in their land. If you will, join me in prayer. God of unfailing love, with confidence we gather to worship you, to praise your holy name, to express to you our trust and confidence in your promise of security and your refuge within your loving presence. Within the safety of your love, we honor you for the commitment you have made to your people and pray that your people will respond to that love with trust and an acceptance of God's merciful forgiveness. If only all of your people showed the same commitment to you, O God, as you show towards them, they would know a life lived within God's presence is one that is rich beyond our understanding and with a depth of inner peace that can only be hoped for and dreamed about. O God, our rock and our redeemer, you are our stronghold against the forces within human life that confront us each day, which try to shake our faith and resolve. So we look to you in confidence and trust. We pour out our hearts to you, O God, because our love is there waiting to lovingly respond to our needs and quietly waits to offer us love and acceptance and a secure road to travel that will lead us to our home in you. Thanks be to God, our rock, our redeemer, and our refuge. Dear God, we are thankful that people in our congregation have returned home from hospitals and rehabilitation. We remember those who are suffering this week in pain. We remember those suffering from addiction, those who are mourning the loss of loved ones. We pray all of this in the many and holy names of God. Amen.
The scripture lessons this morning are the ones that Pastor Larry was referring to. First is Psalm 62, verses 5 through 12. I depend on God alone, and I put my hope in him. He alone protects and saves me. He's my defender, and I shall never be defeated. My salvation and honor depend on God. He is my strong protector. He is my shelter. Trust in God at all times, my people. Tell him all your troubles, for he is our refuge. Human beings are all like a puff of breath. Great and small alike are worthless. Put them on the scales and they weigh nothing. They are lighter than a mere breath. Don't put your trust in violence. Don't hope to gain anything by robbery. Even if your riches increase, don't depend on them. More than once I have heard God say that power belongs to him and that his love is constant. You yourself, O God, reward everyone according to their deeds. The second scripture lesson comes from Luke 4, 21 through 30. And this is the New International Version, in case you're following along. Then he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is not this Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, 'Doctor, cure yourself,' and you will say, 'Do hear also in your hometown the things that we have heard you did in Capernaum?' And he said, 'Truly I will tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown. But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel at the time of Elijah. And when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, there was a severe famine all over the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them except to a widow, Zaphareth in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel at the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them were cleansed except Naaman the Syrian. When they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up and drove him out of town, led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him over the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way." For the word of the scripture, for the word among us, for the word within us, thanks be to God.
Psalm 62 is written in a time when folks of the Old Testament, the Hebrew people, proclaimed one God, while many other faiths around them claimed many gods. The psalm seems to be making the case for the holy one and only. The psalm doesn't mention any other deities or gods, but it does name riches as a god that we create sometimes in our hearts, and sometimes it's something that we place our confidence in, sort of a confidence-setting goal. This teaching is as important today as it was back then, when we consider economic security and insecurity. It matters not whether we are feeling of low or high estate. It's important to take time and evaluate or check in with ourselves on where we are feeling with our own feelings about being financially secure or insecure, and spend time in meditation and prayer to see what directions we should be taking with such matters. Reflect on a time when you weren't feeling so secure, on the outside or the inside. How did your faith pull you through? One translation of verse 5 of this psalm that Louise read says this: "My soul, wait in silence for God alone, for my expectation is from him." So there's always silence involved in growing our faith. Ours is a noisy culture. Our modern world is filled with noise. Some call it noise pollution. The Noise Pollution Clearinghouse at www.nonoise.org says that the word noise is derived from the Latin word nausea, meaning sickness, seasickness. Noise is something the most pervasive pollutants that we have today in our society. Noise from road traffic, jet planes, jet skis, garbage trucks, construction equipment, manufacturing processes, lawnmowers, leaf blowers, boomboxes are only a few to name. And among the audible litter that are routinely broadcast into the air. Some argue noise negativity affects human health and well-being. Problems related to noise include hearing loss, stress, high blood pressure, sleep loss, distraction, and lost productivity. There are even anti-noise groups, BLAST, ban leaf blowers and save our town, horn, halt outrageous railroad noise, roar, residents opposed to airport racket. Our Christian brothers and sisters, the Quakers, are known for long periods of silence in their worship services. It is not unusual for the congregation to sit silently for 30 minutes or an hour. And then maybe someone will be inspired to stand and say a few words. The Quakers are a wonderfully quiet people. They have a great phrase which describes what we should do when we come to worship. They call it centering down. Centering down, as the Quakers call it, is reaching a quiet core within yourself. And it is all the more essential today in a culture that has lost its appreciation for silence and gentle ambient sounds. The boombox on the beach that drowns out the waves, the iPod carried on a run around the park, the cell phone required for any car trip longer than 5 minutes. It's as if people are afraid to be alone with themselves. The well-known Quaker George Fox used to say, "Carry some quiet around inside you. Be still and cool in your own mind and spirit, and then you will feel the principle of God to turn your mind to the Lord from whence cometh life, whereby you may receive the strength and power to allay all storms and tempests." I love that appeal for the quiet within us. We do need to be still and cool. In another verse from this psalm, we read, "My salvation and honor depend on God. He is my strong protector. God is my shelter." There was a 1936 movie that was made from a Broadway play called The Green Pastures. The movie tells the story of how God first sent Moses and then the prophets to call his people back to him, and when all else fails, sends his son to share their suffering. All the angels grow exasperated with the rebellion of humankind. Time and time again in the play, in sort of a comedic fashion, Gabriel wants to blow his horn and bring it all to an end. Gabriel repeatedly implores to God, "Now, Lord, can I blow the trumpet now?" But each time, God holds out in patience. Finally, one of the angels watching the chaos on earth exclaims, "Everything nailed down is coming loose." Yet still, God would not give up. Have you ever felt that way in your life, that everything nailed down was coming loose? Have you ever felt that a seismic event had shaken your world beyond recognition? The Bible provides hope for us in just such times as that. For the Bible often speaks to people facing cataclysmic events. I believe these would be important passages, this psalm today, for brothers and sisters in Tonga. One last phrase from the psalm comes, "Trust in God at all times, you people. Pour your hearts out before God. God is a refuge for us." The Bible often talks about the importance of confession and talking to God. There are those times when we need to pour out our hearts to God. God is big enough to hear and accept whatever we have to say. When we pour out our hearts, we will find refuge. We can count on the steadfast presence of God. That's the major theme of this psalm. I think it must have been a lesson that Jesus learned and knew when we hear about today's gospel story. He was rejected in the temple and led out of town by a crowd that wanted to throw him over a hill. "When my time comes, I'll just take a pink slip, please." When the leader of the synagogue turned the service over to Jesus, who came forward and sat in the preaching chair and read from the Isaiah scroll, Jesus launched into his sermon, and people felt that he was doing an excellent ministry of preaching. But suddenly, the atmosphere changed inside the building. Anger surfaced to a boiling point. Why? What was the cause of that? The obvious reason was the compliment that Jesus paid to the Gentiles. The Jews believed that they were God's exclusive people. Anyone else was just fuel for hell's fire. Jesus had the audacity to include these Gentiles in God's kingdom. They were exclusive. Gentiles? No way. Don't forget these were Jesus' friends and neighbors who had known him for years, and many of them since childhood. These friends and neighbors were so incensed that they seized him and took him outside the synagogue to a cliff, ready to throw him to his death. According to the scripture, he walked through the crowd and left. I don't know if this was a miracle or not, but he escaped with his life. And what was the consequences of Jesus and his message being rejected by the Nazarene community? He never returned to his hometown to minister in God's name again. When they were rejecting Jesus and his ministry, they were rejecting the ministry of kindness. The ministry of kindness develops around individual responses to life. The story is told that when William McKinley was president of the United States, a decision about an appointment of an ambassador to a foreign country had to be made. Two equally qualified candidates were being considered. However, when McKinley was a congressman, an incident occurred that would sway his decision. One of the candidates had been on the same streetcar at rush hour as McKinley. All of the seats were taken, and eventually an elderly lady boarded the streetcar with a large and heavy basket of clothes. No one offered her a seat as the car swayed from side to side, causing her to lose her balance more than once. She was standing next to one of the men that was being considered for the ambassadorship years later. Instead of getting up and offering her his seat, he deliberately shifted his newspaper so it would look like he hadn't noticed her. When McKinley saw this, he walked down the aisle and took her basket and offered her his seat. The other man was unaware that anyone was watching, but his total lack of kindness would later cost him a job he so dearly desired. The scriptures are filled with acts of kindness from the hands of Jesus, from healing to the raising of the dead. His words encouraged people to see themselves for who they really were. I love this quote by Rabbi Harold Kushner. When you carry out acts of kindness, you get a wonderful feeling inside. It is as though something inside your body responds and says, yes, this is how I ought to feel. The Israelites' expectation of the coming Messiah was one of anticipation, of a Messiah who would ride in on a white charger and lead a victorious army by defeating the hated Romans. Israel would be restored to its rightful and most powerful political position. Little did they dream that Jehovah would send them himself in the form of a man who would walk the dusty streets rather than ride a white horse. He would tell his followers to be peacemakers and love others above themselves, and to render unto Caesar those things that he required. These things just didn't fit the ideal Messiah, and that is exactly the kind of Messiah they received. In closing, I think we all carry familial, childhood, church, and societal ideas of God in our core values, which often must be shed and relearned. Once again, I invite all of you to consider the read, Unlearning God by Philip Gully, and know that you can know God as your source of strength and refuge. Amen.
Holding your life, we believe.
That was beautiful. This is the time in our worship service where we actively and intentionally take part in the support of the ministry of Christ. If you're a member of the Little Home Church, we encourage you to continue your pledges and financial support. And if you're visiting with us today, we welcome your gifts as well. For those of you who may be watching this on YouTube, the information is on the screen at the close of the service. You may donate by Venmo, PayPal, or by sending a check to the church through the mail. We have been called to speak and to live out the radical, abiding love of God in the world. We do so by offering all that we are, all that we do, and all that we have, knowing that God will use us and our gifts to bring the beloved community, which I hope we get together, ever closer to being realized in the world. Please join me in unison of the offertory prayer. Gracious and loving God, receive our gifts of self and substance. They have belonged to you since our very beginning. We give them freely, joyfully, prayerfully. With them we praise you. With them we celebrate the great power that is love, a love that abides always, a love that radically transforms, a love that makes us whole. Amen.
Shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. Shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, you will comfort me. Forever. helpless look to you for grace. Stained I to the fountain fly. Wash me, Savior, or I die. While I draw this fleeting breath, when my eyes shall close in death, when I soar to worlds unknown, meet you at your judgment throne, Rock of ages cleft for me, let me hide my shelter be.
Receive the benediction. Go forth celebrating faith. Go forth celebrating hope. Go forth celebrating love. Go forth to be the transformed people that God calls us to be. Go forth to transform the world in times of prosperity, but most especially in times of disbelief, hostility, fear, and rejection. Go forth with the knowledge that you are always surrounded by the presence of our steadfast, loving God, our rock and our Redeemer. Go in the knowledge that God is holding your life even as we hold each other. You are not alone. You are loved. May the God in you, the divine image to which you are made, see the God in me, and all of the wonderful saints that will cross our paths in the days that lie ahead. Amen.